both power and authority. And I speak with authority this morning. There's no devil, no imp, no tangleworm, no locust, no demonic force, Lord God, will have this way in this place. We bind the spirit of witchcraft right now. And we send you back to the pits of hell right now, Lord God. We divide every distracting spirit this morning, Lord God. And we send you back to the pits of hell, Lord God. We bind every gossiping spirit this morning. And we send you back to the pits of hell. We bind the prince of the airway. That no interference will come through the airlines, Lord God. No interference through the microphone. No interference through the message. No interference through the worship, Lord God. We thank you that our hearts and our minds will be open to receive what you have for us in this hour, Lord God. We ask you to strengthen our open spirit, our pastor in this hour, Lord God. Oh God, strengthen them for the assignment, Lord God. For the assignment is great, Lord God. And we thank you, Lord God, that we are holding your arms, Lord God. We'll continue to wage war, Lord God. We'll continue to profess what your word says, Lord God. That we are a royal nation and of a priesthood, Lord God. We thank you, God, for we have been adopted into the love, Lord God. So we don't matter what comes our way, Lord God. The victory belongs to us, Lord God. So we honor you in this place, Lord God. We give you honor, we give you praise, Lord God. Forgive us, Lord God, for anything we said, not spoken, Lord God. We want nothing, Lord God, to offend, to offset us, Lord God, for reaching your glory, Lord God. So we give you honor, Lord God. We give you praise, Lord Jesus. Thank you for massaging our hearts this morning, Lord God. You lift in heaviness from hearts this morning, Lord God. I just keep hearing, Lord God, you're restoring, Lord God. So we thank you for restoration, Lord God. We give you honor, we give you praise, Lord Jesus. For it's in your holy name that we do pray. Amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory to your name, Jesus. Well, good morning and welcome to Fresh Anointing House of Worship right now. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We thank you that are listening in via Facebook, our conference calls, as well as our Zoom. Those of you that are listening in via Facebook, please do not forget to share, like, put those thumbs up. Also, please do not forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. It is FAHOW Birmingham. We will have praise and worship, and the next voice you'll be hearing will be our overseer, David Petway. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
Hallelujah.
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 We glorify your name, God.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
Praise your holy name. Lord Albany, come on, stand to your feet this morning. Hallelujah. He's all we need. Every minute of the hour, he's all we need. Come on, put that praise in the atmosphere. Hallelujah. Woo!
You're all I need. Every breath you breathe to me.
You're all I need.
I'll draw all men to me. You're my God.
Thank you. for your power.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for protection.
Thank you, Lord.
Every hour.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for your love.
Thank you for holding.
Thank you for your power.
Thank you for protecting.
Thank you for protection.
Thank you for loving me.
Every hour.
Thank you. Serve the younger, as it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau I have hated. Let's go before the Lord. Father God, we thank and praise and love you. We glorify your name. We thank you for being the good and kind and wonderful God that you are. God, we come this morning empty of ourselves, and Lord, right now asking, Lord, for a fresh infilling of your Holy Spirit. God, you know what we need this morning. And Lord, more than anything, we need you. We need you every day, every second, and every hour. And this morning we're asking you, Lord, have mercy right now in the name of Jesus, God. Have mercy right now on our souls, on our families, on our cities and nations for the glory of God. God, we admit that we're totally useless without you. But we thank you that we can do all things through Christ that strengthens us. So we're coming to you this morning, Lord, of our own intuitions, our own thought patterns, God, our own ways, God. But we're thanking that we're receiving the ways of God. Now, God, we're thanking for leading and guiding us as we go into this word and properly dissect it for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Again, the name of this message is Lord, Have Mercy. And when we think of mercy, a lot of times we're thinking of pity. We're thinking mercy is without power. It is when it's our mercy, but when it's God's mercy, it's full of power. So we're going to look at Lord have mercy in the derivative of miracles and what it entails when it comes to God's miraculous power. When we think of the mercies of God for miracles, it's the mercy that God works in order to heal us. And not only physical healing, but we're talking about emotional healing as well. Let's look at the meaning of mercy when it comes to God. The word for God right now is Elohim, merciful God. And it means compassion from a root word that means to love deeply and to have tender affection. I want you to know that God loves each and every one of us deeply. He loves us compassionately. And he loved us while we were yet sinners, according to Romans 5 and 8. Where he said, while we were yet sinners, Christ what died for us. And then it says to have tender affection. God is affectionate toward us. I don't know how many of you before you became saved thought God was ready to hit you with a bat every time you did something wrong, but I was one of those people. So it is that God loves us so much that he's ready to open his hand to ours, even in the worst of situations. So when it comes to the definition of mercy, mercy is compassion or forbearance shown especially to an offender or one subject to one's power. Also, lenient or compassionate treatment, kind or forgiving treatment of someone who could be treated harshly. Kindness or help given to people who are in a very bad or desperate situation. Now, I've made a proper statement, Lord, have mercy. But I remember growing up when they didn't say proper way, Lord, have mercy. They said, Lord, have mercy. Yeah. It was spelled with an M instead of with the V-E on the end. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. And that means you were in a situation that only God can help you with. And sometimes we need to leave the proper context because we need God to help us now. Not later, but right now. And you could say right now. You can spell it all you want to, but it is an immediate need for God to do something in our lives. Amen? Amen. So it means also lenient or compassionate treatment, a kind of forgiving treatment of someone who could be treated harshly, kindness or help given to people who are in a very bad or desperate situation. Mercy is the compassionate treatment of those in distress, especially if it was within one's power to punish or harm them. And so when we look at all the compassionate things that God wants us to do, we know that this is a compassionate church. This is a church that gives even when it is not commensurate with our size. We give to people who are in need, and we help those who are in need all around. the people know that the only thing they have to do is ask. And if it's any way possible, we're going to meet that need. So we're thanking God for being a church of mercy. But I want you to know that we're looking at mercy in a different context even today. So it is in the legal sense, mercy often refers to compassionate behavior from a person in power, such as when a judge shows clemency, leniency, or mercy during sentencing. I've had the blessing to watch some of the court TV shows, and I know that some judges are very harsh in their sentencing. But I noticed this about the saints of God. There's a special anointing on us even when we go to court. We're not supposed to be in court for anything but positive thing. But I noticed that there's an anointing that calls even the judges to change their mind. Because God's word tells us the king's heart is in his hand. And like the rivers of water, he turned the will of he desired. And so even when we go to court, you'd be surprised how God can turn around decisions. I've been in places where the judge said, they're going to go to jail now. Listen, 10 days later, oh man, we'll turn all around. It's all alleviated. Man, you can tell by the power of God that we have when we know who we are. And God can provide that mercy to whoever he desires. So God shows his mercy for those who are suffering through healing, comfort, alleviation of suffering, and caring about those in distress. He acts from compassion, and he acts with mercy. Deuteronomy 4 and 31, it says here, "For the Lord your God is a merciful God. He will not forsake you, nor destroy you, nor forget the covenant of your fathers which he swore to them." So how is mercy different from compassion? Mercy and compassion are intertwined. Mercy is the fruit of compassion. Now, if you don't get this, you won't get anything else that I say. Mercy is the fruit of compassion. Compassion is what drew Jesus to heal people, but mercy is what actually was produced through that healing. Okay, can you get it? So when it's compassion draws, it's our compassion, we're supposed to be compassionate toward people, but mercy actually asks. There have been people who made a call to us and said, we need this or we need that. Okay, we could have said, yes, we would like to help you, but that would have just been compassion. But mercy says, we've got packages lined up in the office that says, we not only want to help you, but we're going to help you. Somebody said, want to go on.
Want to go on.
Okay, so we are always going to help people that we can. So it's active. So according to the dictionary, mercy is a noun. It is a noun in action. It's a mission performed to relieve suffering. It's an event to be grateful for. It's compassion or forgiveness shown to someone. The meaning of compassion is to recognize the suffering of others and then take action to help. It is an action word. And when we're talking about loving one another and helping one another, I want you to know we're talking about an action word. Some of you are really, God is going to start moving you out, and you've got to realize that you've been saying all along, I want to help them people. Some of us real good at weeping over those sad pictures. Those, you know, the ones where the children are looking a certain way and they just don't let them help. Oh, I wish I could help them. But God's going to put you in a position where you can. So the question is, will you, when the time comes, will you be ready to travel and do those things that God wants us to do? So mercy is a noun, action is a mission performed to relieve suffering, is an event to be grateful for. It is the compassion or forgiveness shown to someone. The meaning of compassion is to recognize the suffering of others and then take action to help. So when we're talking about mercy, the greatest story of mercy, the way we want to define it, mercy itself, is here in chapter 9 to me. And so chapter 9, when we look at it, it starts out in 9 and 1 with the Apostle Paul. And he's talking about how great it would be if his all of Israel would be saved. Because not all Israel will be saved or have chosen to choose God as their Lord and Savior. It is but a remnant, even though God chose them first. And I want you to know you can be chosen by God, but not choose Him, which means that you can be a remnant within what we call a remnant, because Israel was a remnant within the whole world, but within that remnant was those that chose God. And so Paul said, I would give my own life in order that all of Israel would be saved. He's making the same grieving statement that Jesus made as he was on his way into Jerusalem, and he was crying over the city because he knew that he was the Savior and not all would accept him as Savior. You and I have to know that there are those that are going to sit in church and not be part of the remnant that Jesus is coming back for, because they're going to be in church, but they'll not be the church right now. They'll be in church and they'll hear all the great music and they'll hear the great preaching and they'll hear and be just in fellowship, but they will be a part of the lost group because they never received Jesus as Savior and Lord. They came right now for the tradition and religion, but they never accepted the relationship of God. If you ever receive Jesus as Lord and Savior and start walking in relationship, your relationship doesn't end once you leave these church doors. If you are a relative to somebody, you don't unrelative them. No matter where you go, you still a relative. Amen. You got a sister, she your sister, whether you in Africa or Asia or whatever. Brother, the same thing. And with God, when he becomes your relative, when he becomes your father, and Jesus becomes your brother, I want you to know you can't unrelative, because they're deep down on the inside and the Holy Ghost and power is with you. And so when we're looking at this, Paul is very much in despair, and he has the same connotation as Jesus. But then, when it's talking about the ones who are really apart and the ones that are separated, in verse 6 in Romans 9 and 6, he says, not as though the word of God had taken none effect, for they are not all Israel which are Israel. God chose this nation, but I want you to know he chose it sovereignly. He chose this nation not because they were so good, not because they were the people that loved him. They were in an idolatrous place under Abraham. They were in Ur of Chaldees, an idolatrous nation. And God said, I'm just going to pick you out and I'm going to make you my people. Do you know that's what he's done to every one of us? He picked us out not because we were so good. He picked us out just because he made us his choice. And so when we look at this, we're starting to talk about the doctrine of election. And when we're talking about the election, we're talking about divine election. And so there is a great conjecture among theologians whether there's conditional or unconditional election. And when we talk about unconditional election, is that God chooses a certain group of people to be saved, and only that people can be saved no matter what they do. I don't believe in that. I don't believe in what we call unconditional election. What I believe is there is what we call conditional election, and it depends on God's purpose. It depends on us receiving what God has done. Look at what he said with the children of Israel. There are those that didn't choose him, although he chose them. There are those that did not and do not choose God, and they walk out of here week after week and out of church week after week, and they never choose God, but they think they're a part of the kingdom of God because they're in the house. The children of Israel thought they were a part of God's army because they were born into it. But you can be born into it, but you have to be born into the Lord Jesus Christ and accepting him. Somebody that understands what I'm saying, say amen.
Amen.
So it says, neither because they were seed of Abraham are they all children, but in Isaac thy seed shall be called. And so here we go. We can see that Abraham and Sarah have a son, and his name is Isaac, and he's the son of promise. But now Abraham has another son, Ishmael, and he's by Hagar, And he is the son, the illegitimate son. When we think of Abraham and we think of Hagar, there's an illegitimacy in there because they are now, they say, that Sarah said, Abraham, God is waiting too long. This promise was made when Abraham was 75 and Sarah was 65. And so he's saying, you're waiting too long for God, because they waited a long time for God to fulfill his promise. And he said, she said, well, we're going to help God along. How many of you know when you help God along, you ain't doing too good? Right. You're operating according to the flesh. How many of us have tried to help God along? We tried to, you know, call somebody in order to pay a bill, or call somebody in order to do this or do that, or call somebody and think that they're going to be praying for you, and all they do is criticize you. We've been in those conditions, but we need to know the only thing that God looks at is his predestined ordination towards you and whether you choose him as your Lord and Savior. So they created an Ishmael, and Ishmael was not a son of promise. The promise was given to Abraham and Sarah. And so the only way that they could be God's children was to be born through Abraham and Sarah, which produced an Isaac. Somebody say Isaac.
Isaac
is the son of promise right now. He's the promise that God gave them. And a lot of us want to really rush God's promises along. We want to rush them along. God, okay, God, I can see you on this. So here they are, and finally Isaac comes, but it's impossible because Abraham is now near 100 years old and Sarah near 90 when they have a child. And my God, it's too late. But do you know when God wants to birth something in you, he can birth it in you no matter how old you are. No matter what's going on, no matter what the hindrances of you, he can birth it in you, which means that some of you ladies can still have a child right now. Amen. So no matter how impossible it is right now. So okay. So that is, they which are the children of the flesh are not the children of God, but the children of promise accounted for the seed. So now we have the Gentiles who are grafted in. They're grafted in, and they can become children of God by simply receiving the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior right now. And we are the Gentiles who are grafted in. And so when we are grafted in, the only requirement is that we believe and we receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and we become disciples of the living God. Then in verse 9 it says, for this is the word of promise, at this time will I come to Sarah to have a son. And not only this, but when Rebekah also had conceived by one, even by our father Isaac, for the children not yet being born, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth. Now here's where the contradiction comes in. Because you can understand that when Abraham has two sons, one by Sarah and one by Hagar, one's the son of promise and one is the son of the flesh, you can understand why there might be a disparity. There might be a cutting off. You can understand why God would say that right now these are the children of promise and these are the children of the flesh. You can understand it when you look at Isaac and you look at his son Ishmael. You can understand what's going on. What you can understand is when Isaac and Rebekah have two sons and they're twins and they're in the womb, and God makes the statement while they're in the womb that the older will serve the younger, which means that it was out of order. It meant that, wait just a minute, the older or the elder always gets a double portion, and the younger is the one that received just a single portion. And it was so much about in the womb that you have babies wrestling in the womb, and God let her know that there were two nations wrestling in her womb, and this is before they even got out the womb. And they're wrestling in the womb. And then what happened is that Jacob and Esau are wrestling, but Esau is going out first. And Jacob is so mad, even in the mother's womb, he's just bust the sack of water, and he's grabbing him by the heel, and they name him a heel grabber. Because he's saying, wait just a minute, I want to be first. But then there comes in the question of God's mercy right now, because wait just a minute. It has always been that the first would be first and double portion, and the second and would be the one that got a single portion. So how can you say now that you're going to change things up when it's been that way always? Let me tell you what God is doing this in this season. The last will be first. Come on now. If you've been last, oh, it's time for you to move to the position, yes, of first. Yes. You just got to believe it. Now, even though he grabbed his heel, he desired first. He wanted first. But my question is, how bad do you want to be first and not for your own glory? Because God sees something in you, yes, that says that when I'm first, I'm going to turn into the person that's going to be a blessing to the kingdom of God. Yes. And so when he comes out the womb right now, the name of Jesus, they come out, but now it looks like God has favored Esau a little bit more, because Esau has red hair, he's a hunter, he's a man's man, and then Jacob is a mama's boy. It looked like it's out of place to me, because if I was God, Jacob would be the man. But here is Esau right now. I mean, Esau would be the man, but here's Jacob right now, and Jacob's right there always under his mama's arm. Oh, but daddy can't stand him. Whenever he wants something to eat, Esau, go out and get me something to eat. Esau, go kill a bear, lion, or deer. Bring it back to him, cut it up, and cook too. But look at Jacob under his mama's arm. His probably talking about him like I don't know what. Mama's boy, he'll never be there. But you know what? When God chooses you,
amen,
glory, hallelujah, it doesn't matter who's on you.
All right.
Because God has properly positioned you. See, that's when divine election takes place, because God elected him even from the womb, because he said right now in the name of Jesus that Jacob would be first. But even in the womb, even though Esau came out first, it doesn't matter your physical position, but what does God say about you?
Right.
People can be talking about you all your life long. They can be right now saying, you ain't going to be this, you ain't going to be that, you ain't nothing, and you'll never amount to nothing. But let me tell you what, when God ordains you from the womb, it may take a little while, but I'm going to tell you, when God ordains you, you're going to come out first, and the same one that looked at you one way going to have to turn to you for another. So they get out the womb, and all of a sudden, is that Esau disregards his birthright. Some of you have a birthright in Christ, a birthright to know, a birthright to grow, a birthright to learn more. And God is saying, you got a birthright, and what are you doing with the birthright? You have the anointing to be more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus.
Yeah.
That no weapon that's formed against you shall prosper. And even when I was wrestling with the witches this morning, I knew who I was. I said, the fire of God, the angels of God. I said, the blood of Jesus, because I knew who I was in Christ. And sometimes you gotta send the fire and the blood and the angels of God to destroy the works of the enemy, because you've got to know that the enemy has tentacles. That he has tentacles, and he tried to plant them everywhere. He tried to plant them in our minds right now. And the greatest battle that you ever seen is going on in the minds of the people of God right now. You think that because you're saved, the enemy won't mess with your mind? Yes, he will. He'll fight your mind like never before. And that's why God said, cast down imagination and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God and bring to captivity every thought into the obedience of Jesus Christ our Lord. And when he comes back again and again, you rebuke him again and again. You don't stop rebuking the enemy right now, no matter what. Because he's going to keep coming right now. Been stopped in billions and trillions of years. What you think that he's going to stop now? And so here they are, two sons right now.
Yes.
And one is anointed by God to be first, but one in the family to be first. Glory, hallelujah, right now. There's something about, you know, being last in the family, being told you're no good and never amount to anything. I was told that all my life by our stepfather, right now in the name of Jesus, but God saw different than right now. He didn't see who God made man. Glory, hallelujah. You can talk about it, but you got to realize that God made you who he made you. And you have ability to step out of that once you begin to walk in all that God has for you right now. Can't be jealous of folk right now.
Amen.
Glory, hallelujah. There are folk that are more anointed than you, seemingly more appointed than you. Glory, hallelujah, better looking than you. Glory, hallelujah. But you got to know that God has made you who he has made you. And the glory of God rests upon you right now. So here they are, they're walking around. And they're walking around in this one with this boldness in the flesh. And one with just seeking God and wanting the birthright that belonged to his brother. And so all of a sudden, the father's ready to give away the birthright right now. And he's ready to give away the birthright. And he gives it right now. He says, before I give it, I want Esau to go and fix me some porridge. But on the way, mom gets with her favorite son, Jacob. And they trick the father into blessing Jacob. And Esau comes back and he's distorted. He's distraught. Why is that? Because he sold beforehand, he sold his birthright for a bowl of soup. I'm going to say soup, they're the pirate, but soup. He sold his birthright, which meant that he disregarded the thing that was most valuable in the kingdom of God. Let me tell you what. There's a birthright that everyone in the kingdom of God have to be a son and a daughter of God.
Yes.
There's a birthright that you have that you carry on as a lineage that right now, the name of Jesus, you can pass down to generation, and there'll be greatness down to generation that it can change the lives of your son and your daughter and your grandchildren because you decided that you were going to follow Jesus. That birthright is given to you the minute you accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and decide to follow him. You say, but they won't follow me. They're talking about me. They won't give me. But it hasn't seemed to follow Jesus right now. Because there's no man I ever seen, a woman I've seen, that if they saw somebody following Jesus, they would not follow Jesus also. There's been stories of atheists, men that denied there was a God and denied there was God. And they were challenged to read the Bible. And upon reading the Bible, they became the greatest Christians, the greatest disciples this world has ever seen. Because they received the birthright. They read the word of God and it was undeniable. They tried to prove it in caves. They tried to prove it everywhere they could. But they could not prove the Bible. The Bible proved that Jesus is Lord. So what am I saying to you? You must begin to receive the birthright right now. God didn't mean you to walk in poverty. Didn't mean for us to walk in lack. Didn't mean us to walk in sadness and all those things. God meant us to walk in joy right now.
Yes.
The joy of the Lord is your strength, and the devil wants to take away our strength. But as we go on before, it says, and it said unto her, meaning Rebecca, the elder will serve the younger. As it written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. Oh my God, that begins a treatise where Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. Do you mean that God hates or wants us to hate someone? No, he doesn't. But he wants us, relative to the love we have for God, to hate mama, father, sister, brother, anybody. The love of God must be so much greater than any of that. What does that do when our love is that great compared to the love of God? It keeps us from getting into situations where we begin to say, God, I just can't forgive. God, I cannot love. God, I can't make my children my idols. It keeps us from that situation where we're making things greater than God. Because if I make God greater, it's like the things I want. People want their families to come together. They want to have things that are good. They want things. But if God is not in place, Matthew 6 and 33 tells us to seek ye first what? The kingdom of God and his what? Righteousness and what? All these things will be added unto us. Your family, your husband, your wife, your children, that's just a thing with God. Your job and peace on that, that's just a thing with God. You're trying to come into a life, that's a thing with God. But if you put God first, he'll align everything else right now. And we have to know that. So it says, what shall you say then? Is there unrighteousness with God? God forbid. And so when he says this, according to one son and both of them in the womb, we had no problem with Isaac, and we had no problem with Ishmael, because one was a child of the spirit and one was a child of the flesh. But now it comes to Susan that are born inside the womb of a woman, and they have not yet done anything good or anything evil. And we have a problem with that as human, because right now we have nothing to judge it on. We are easy, because listen, when we look at Ishmael, it's easy to judge, and we're good at judgment. He don't deserve it, because Abraham did wrong. But with these two, neither one of them were in the capacity coming out of the womb that we could judge and say that that was wrong right now. But now we have to look at God and say, is God wrong? Can God be wrong? And the question to that is no. God can never be wrong. He's never wrong, no matter what it, because God's word says, according to Romans 8:28, how many things work together for the good?
All
things work together for the good. It doesn't mean that we can't understand God. It doesn't mean that we understand everything that he does. Let me put it that way. We don't understand everything he does, but when we don't understand, God tells us to trust in the Lord with what? And lean not to our what? Acknowledge him in all our ways and what? And he's going to direct our path. So we should know that God is in charge. He says in verse 15, for he said to Moses, I will have what? Mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. Now, when we say, Lord, have mercy, this is one of those where the parents might be saying, Lord, I had more than one child. And when I had the more than one child, one turned out bad and one turned out good. God, why is it that I gave them the same love? I gave them the same attention. I gave them the same thing, but one turned out bad and the other one not. Lord, are you righteous, God? I spent all my time in church and I did what I was supposed to do and it didn't turn out right. But Lord, I need you to have mercy on me right now, because I need the mercy. I know you can't heal what's going on right now if they're gone, but I need the mercy to apply to me right now.
right now, because right now I need your mercy that produces a fruit. And what is the fruit that mercy can produce when we have wayward children and things are not going right? The mercy produces a fruit that says, right now, I'm going to work with somebody else's kid. I'm going to bless somebody else's kid. I'm going to touch somebody else's kid's life. And when you begin to touch somebody else, guess what God does? He begins to touch yours. So God is saying this mercy that we're talking about is the mercy right now to heal and deliver and set free. And then it comes up that, wait just a minute, God, are you fair? And that comes through the election of God. And God can elect right now and do what he wants to do simply because he's God. Some of us need to stop crying about all the things that happen to us negative, because there are negative things going to happen. And some things God allows right now. Glory, hallelujah, I wish it was. But God allows right now. Is the enemy doing what God has to allow? Because nothing can happen on the earth that God does not allow. But what God wants to see is right now, how is mercy affecting you? Even through that thing, I gave you the strength to stand up. I gave you the strength to go on. I gave you the strength to call on my name. I gave you the strength right now to glorify me right now. And I want you to know that's the kind of strength that we need today. We need mercy right now. You talk about mercy, we need it right now in our personal soul. I need mercy right now, because I keep messing up and God keep forgiving me. And if that mercy comes right now to me, I must begin to say, God, I know I'm messing up, but I've got to change my ways. Because if I don't change my ways, I'm not giving you regard. The regard that Esau gave you is not regard that you have. You have the regard that Jacob had for the promise. Yes, right now they named him Jacob, and he was trickster, manipulator, all those things. But I want you to know, in spite of the name they gave him, he was headed to where God had purposed him. And you know the thing about God, when we are going through the thing God purposed for us, there's some hills and there are some valleys. There are some things that happen that we'd rather not happen. But man, when we begin to submit to God, he begins to right now show us that right now, you're on my path. It don't look like it. It doesn't feel like it. Man, you almost see it right now. There was great anguish in my heart for months right now, because I felt like there was something else, and all I could think of was, God, what am I doing? Where am I going? When will I get there? And instead, God had me going and going. And I've got a little view on what God is doing now, but it's just a small speck. But I know there'll be tests and trials. And I want to let you know there are going to be tests and trials. But the thing is, can you keep going right now? Can you keep listening to the word? Because sometimes we think we're bigger than the word that's going on. But I want you to know that you need every word that you can have. When the times get tough, every word that's spoken will be the word that you need. There are people that miss church. And when they miss church, they got to realize that you're missing what will help you in the week that is about to come. And you ought to know that when God begins to move in your life, it's going to be some tough time. And when we look at Jacob, and he did all that tricky stuff, and he had to run right now. And the question is, wait just a minute. People can see why he didn't choose Esau. Esau went and married a woman that wasn't even Jewish, and women that wasn't Jewish. He did all kind of things to frustrate his father. He didn't regard the birthright. But my question is, you didn't choose Esau, but why did you choose Jacob? Why did you choose Jacob? Jacob was messed up, man. Wanna trick your own daddy? Help him and take your brother's blessing? And then run off and marry a woman that had the wrong eyes. He didn't even look in the eyes the night y'all consummated the marriage. He was a dog. Come on now. You wake up in the morning and you find out you're with the wrong woman. You shouldn't look that eyes at least that night.
You're too dark.
You know, something wrong with that. You know, even if you look at eyes, they probably wouldn't the same size. You know. Put it like that picture where the guy was fitting Ray Charles when he felt the arm. You know, see what side the wrist was.
Okay,
come on, man.
She was the right one.
Somebody said, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Oh, my God.
But when they are at conjecture, God is saying in verse 16, so then it is not of him that willeth, nor of him that runneth, but of God that showeth mercy.
Yes, yes.
So if I will and if I run without God's mercy, it just means that I'm going to be fruitless in my effort. Anything not backed by God is fruitless. We need to know that God wants us right now to be willing vessels in his anointing and everything that he's doing right now to make his name great. The one thing that I really want to us to really look at when I say, Lord, have mercy, just look at some of the things that are happening that we need God's mercy in and how mercy was applied to heal and deliver. We saw it even in the sense of Jacob and how God delivered him, and it was his mercy. It wasn't because Jacob was so good. It wasn't because he was so kind. It wasn't that he did things right. It was just God's mercy. For forgiveness or withholding punishment. Psalm 51:1. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercy. Blot out my transgression. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgression and my sin is always before me. David is saying, Lord, have mercy, as he created two of what we call the greatest sins that we can do. He's committed murder and adultery. And this really asking of God is, Lord, have mercy on my soul. And we look at deliverance. We're talking about Matthew 17:14-19. A man approaches Jesus and kneels before him saying, Lord, have mercy on my son. He has seizures and is suffering greatly. He often falls into the fire and into the water. When we think of our children and we think of the grace when it comes to our children, we need to have God's mercy. And this man is saying, my son falls into the fire, which is a sense of epilepsy. But you know what Jesus did when he had said, have mercy? He healed.
Yes.
And that's what he wants to do to each one of us. Healing the blind. As Jesus approached Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard the crowd going by, he asked what was happening. They told him, Jesus of Nazareth is passing by. He called out, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. Those who led the way rebuked him and told him to be quiet. But he shouted all the more, son of David, have mercy on me. I want you to know, when you're desperate enough, you won't let anyone quit you or stop you from saying, Lord, have mercy. You won't let anyone stop you from really reaching out to God. And I just believe this is one of those moments where, please stand. And we'd like to say goodbye to our Facebook family. Thank you.